'Tis the season to be metal. And what better way to end off a phenomenal year for hard rock and heavy metal than to count down the top 10 best hard rock and heavy metal albums of this year. But don't tell that to the Billboard 200 or else they'll take all those Imagine Dragons songs off their lists. You know, it's pretty bad when my girlfriend, who knows about as much about hard rock or heavy metal as Dimebag Daryl knows how to not get shot, took one glance at this list and actually inquired, "Where are the rock songs?" It was for that reason alone that I decided to make this video, as top 10 videos are typically for normies like WatchMojo or Cover Killer. Now, there have been a lot of great albums this year, so there will be an honorable mentions. Also, I will not be putting EPs, compilation albums, live albums, reissues, or re-recordings on this list, so I don't want to see bitching in the comments section for why the new Sodom EP or Re-Idolized ain't on this list, despite how good they may be. With that, grab a snack, grab a beverage, and let's delve straight into the best hard rock and heavy metal albums of 2018. Upfront about this, Venom have no bad albums. Even their worst album is still pretty damn good, so it's not much of a shocker that the founders of black metal put out yet another bitchin' album by the name of Storm the Gates, which storm it does right from the opening riff. Yet somehow the tasteless cunts at Metal Archives are still unleashing the Kraken on this album. Shitty production, they shriek. Sophocles, have you listened to Venom before? Let me rephrase that. Have you listened to a black metal album before? What the fuck were you expecting? The production from Nevermind or Heaven and Hell? The riffs are generic and they suck! But enough about the battle jacket wearing fat asses over there. Venom's Storm the Gates is yet another solid release by the band with some damn good songs on it. And in classic Venom fashion, there's even some comedy.
Hey you motherfucker, what you looking at? Born a fucking loser, acting like a twat. Talking Navarato, in a lightning joke. Walking like a loser, gonna bust your nose.
Best song? There's no shortage of good songs on this album, but my personal favorite has to be Over My Dead Body. Worst song? Fuck off, there ain't one. Storm the Gates is another by-the-numbers Venom album, and it's damn fucking good. Next. In 2017, Accept released yet another scorching album by the name of The Rise of Chaos. And just 1 year later, the Duke of Schneider hit back hard with the literal face-melting Steel Factory. It was actually in Udo's own words where he stated that Steel Factory was influenced not only by Accept's The Rise of Chaos, but while touring under the Dirk Schneider name, performing nothing but Accept songs from 2015 to 2018 as a sort of farewell to playing Accept songs, which you can definitely hear a mix of classic and modern Accept in some of these songs. We are hungry and angry. We are best song? For me, it's a tie between Keeper of My Soul and the anthemic One Heart, One Soul. One heart, one soul, one love forever. One name, one goal, one love for all. Do yourself a favor and buy some Steel Factory and The Rise of Chaos while you're at it. Next! Ghost have been rising up through the ranks these past few years, from obscure to performing on The Late Show with Kami Colbert.
Performing the song Cerise from the album Meliora, Ghost.
To opening for Iron Maiden on the Book of Souls World Tour, to now charting number 3 on the US Billboard 200, which we won't hold that against them, and now packing arenas nationwide, Ghost are the new rising stars of modern metal and they're taking the world by storm. And then Prequel came on barreling down the birth canal. While some view this album as a betrayal to their previous three albums, it's fucking great! It's popular to say, bitch, have you heard Year Zero, Square Hammer, He Is, Idolatry, or how about that one song that was literally nominated for Best Metal Song in 2015, Cerise? All of these popular ass songs have poppy overtones, you knobs, and to say that Prequel has no metal in it at all, it's just fucking absurd. Look no further than the titty fucking lead single. Not to mention my personal favorite song on the album, Faith. Fuck, it's like if Blue Oyster Cult fucked Black Sabbath with some anti-striper thrown in and it's just fucking glorious. Is it on the poppy side? Yeah, but even then, the pop songs really aren't bad either. Don't you forget about dying. Don't you forget about your friend death. Don't you forget that you will die. Don't you forget about dying. Don't you forget about your friend death. Now, I'm not saying I'd be putting this album over the Titan that was Meloria, but Prequel is certainly a worthy follow-up for sure, and speaking of fucking absurd...
If you do something about it, I'd just stand there and bleed.
have to say, when Sully Ernest said that the new Godsmack album was going to be commercial, I just about shot fire from my eyeballs like one of the forges from Forged in Fire.
Very quickly, what have you noticed about the new songs?
I noticed that they have a lot more of a commercial aspect to them. So far, there's some stuff in there that definitely will service the core fan base of Godsmack. But we also felt that it's time to expand a little bit. You know, we could continue to write the same record, but we're gonna have the same results. And the way I see it is we're taking the first 20 years and we're logging that into our catalog. That was one chapter of our career, and that's the more nostalgic vintage Godsmack. And from this point forward, we're gonna try to reinvent a little bit more of our sound, our look, our stage show, and come out with a brand new Godsmack. Because we've realized that since we came out 20 years ago, there's a whole new generation that's grown up that are now just starting to discover Godsmack, and we want to be smart about this, and we also want to try to expand our fan base without alienating the core audience. So it's a little challenging. We may lose some along the way, but hopefully we lose one and we gain 20, and you can do the math at the end.
All right.
Then they released the lead single, Bulletproof, and while it wasn't really a first-round knockout, I didn't really hate it either. But I promise you that I'll make sure you never forget me. Now that you want it, now that you need it, I'm too far gone. You're trying to play me, but I'm not breaking. I'm telling. But as the song grew on me a little more, the band leaked the Teddy fucking title track, and then I was fucking ready. The album dropped not too long after, and besides like 2 week tracks, it's not really a half bad commercial hard rock album, which is probably why the Alex Jones of music reviewers and his Mellow Archives music taste fucking hated it.
Number two, though, is Godsmack with When Legends Rise. When have I ever talked about Godsmack on a negative list or any list, really? This is a first! This is literally a first! Because Godsmack was one of those groups that came out during the late 90s that always had a sound that did set them apart and made them a little bit unique. Whether it was Solly's voice, whether it was the fact that they were towing the line closer to heavy metal, and then, you know, even their acoustic stuff has a lot to offer. The Other Side EP being a fantastic representation of that. But When Legends Rise took all the edge, took every good thing that Godsmack had going for them, and completely abandoned it. They completely abandoned it for a more streamlined, very radio-friendly sound. Maybe it was because the last couple of albums didn't have the sales that were really expected. Maybe this is something where record labels are buying into the idea that rock and fringe-line metal is dead. They've been buying into the bullshit from Gene Simmons and these other just idiots, Adam Levine, that just spout this garbage, that want to put the death knell into something that they supposedly were a part of. When Legends Rise is a boring disc that has no soul at all. This is almost like the guys just went in there, realized that their record label was demanding a different sound, gave them exactly that, and tried to pass it off like a Godsmack album. It is not a Godsmack album. This album is pure garbage. The legends aren't rising. No, no, no. The legends rose 20 years ago, and now legends have fell. They have fallen. They are gone. It is almost as though there was a great battle, and there is a younger man, or even an older man, or nobody at all. It could have been pure air, oxygen. Slice them down with a sword. They're done. They're gone. Unless, of course, their next album proves themselves to have some worth, but somehow I doubt that. We probably won't get that until 2024.
We're even listening to the same album here, Mojo? Listen, Fatty Arbuckle, Godsmack have been practically making the same fucking album over and over and over again, which in essence hasn't really been a bad thing, seeing as their previous six albums have been pretty damn good, which is the best endorsement I can give to a new metal band. But Sully's 50 years old now, so do I blame him and presumably the other band members for wanting to finally do something fucking different after 20 years of putting out the same fucking albums over and over and over again for a genre that's been dead since 2005? Not at all. But what do you expect from Cover Killer? I mean, what, he worked at FYE, didn't he? I mean, yeah, that's a shame. I mean, I remember when I worked there, the manager was trying to turn me into the clones from the Khaki Bar, and I'd make a fat joke about Cover Killer, but I'm sure he's got enough on his plate right now. Oh wait, I'm heartless. That wasn't a moon Thanos threw at the Avengers, it was Cover Killer's fat ass. What's this guy in? Fitness protection? I mean, I know Dunkin' Donuts and Krispy Kreme is delicious and all, but do you ever just look in the mirror and think, maybe this fourth chin really isn't that attractive? Let's talk about that hair, shall we? Or rather, lack of. Bro, if you lose any more hair, you're gonna look like a stick of deodorant with eyebrows and a pair of shades. But anyway, let's get back to the fucking music. Look, I ain't saying this is a masterpiece or even Godsmack's best album, but come on! I get that there are some bad tracks. Unforgivable.
I'm seeing it. I feel a rise inside me. It's untouchable.
Unforgettable, yeah, unlike this song. But the peaks heavily outweigh the valleys. And look, bitch tits, Sully fucking warned us what When Legends Rise is gonna be months in advance, and you presumably bought it and complained about it anyway? That's on you, assholes. But to say that this album ain't heavy at all is a bold-faced lie. The title track, Take It to the Edge, Say My Name, and the Titanic album closer and my personal favorite song, The Eye of the Storm.
In the eye of the storm. Stand with a broke-down spirit. You're crawling in the middle. Don't you point your finger in my face. 'Cause every bad decision that you made, you're living within everyone.
When Legends Rise, not an album for everyone, but if you want a catchy hard rock album, this is the album for you, man. Fucking next. Yeah, I've heard it before.
A guy named Baphomet666 likes Christian fagaloons like Striper?
Look, you pant-shitting retards, what's the difference between Iron Maiden, Black Sabbath, and Queen writing songs about religion, and fucking Striper writing songs about religion? Look, I'm the most agnostic motherfucker you'll ever meet. Religion ain't my strong suit, but bitchin' heavy metal is, and Goddamn Evil is bitchin' heavy metal. Right from the beginning, albeit opening with a fairly goofy headbanger. Sure, there's some sappy bullshit by the name of Sorry, but even that's saved by the pure music talent. While Michael Sweet's voice is still somehow perfectly intact as it was on Soldiers Under Command, he does implement a little bit more of a rasp to his vocals that he rarely ever used before, and I have to say, it works pretty damn well. Best song? I'll swear on the Bible, but... Whoa. Best song? The Valley. But I'd be remiss not to mention the scorching album closer, The Devil Doesn't Live Here. Satan, who art in hell, hallowed be thy pitchfork. Worst song? Not a one, folks, but I do have to say that I did prefer Fallen just a little bit over Goddamn Evil, but don't let that stop you from buying this exceptional album. Also, I hope you're doing better, Ozfox, and keep on fighting. Next! For those unaffiliated with them, they're a German-American metal band that initially began as a King Diamond tribute band, which should be pretty obvious right from the onset with the band name and the lead vocalist looking like King Diamond's ringmaster cousin. But after performing for 3.5 years and over 20 shows, including performances with Mike Weed and Hal Patino from King Diamond's solo band, and eventually growing a little bored by playing only King Diamond covers, vocalist Troy Nord decided in 2014 that it was time to start writing some original music. And Satan in a red skin tight latex bondage suit, did they write some good shit. But then it was time for the sophomore effort, and Jesus, what a fucking album. Now, I love King Diamond and all, but I do have to say, and I'm being perfectly honest, I'm starting to prefer them over the Kinks. See, I know I'm gonna get some flack for this, but I kind of find King Diamond's falsetto, how do I say this? Well, I kind of find it fucking whiny. And before you type out your poorly written death threats, hear me out for a second. Look, I still love The King, and The Graveyard is my favorite album by him, by the way, but I would just have to put them and this fucking album up against any King Diamond album, and that's a compliment and a half, so quit your bitching. Best song? I love the shit out of As the Sage Burns. Chaotic bones that broke him free before the last fight banished to hell. In the final moment he never takes back. Worst song, again, not a one, folks, although the story tracks are, you know, you can throw them away, but they're not bad. Buy it! I'm gonna be blunt but honest. I'm absolutely terrible at keeping up with modern heavy metal for the sole reason of most of the newer metal bands kind of suck ass through a bendy straw. Probably the newest metal bands I'm a fan of are Ghost, which are 12 going on 13 years old, and Godsmack, which are 20 going on 21 years old. So, yeah, it wasn't until my friend and Over the Rainbow podcast co-host, Alos, aka the Neon God, introduced me to two bands, one of them being them, and the other being Carriage. Forming in 2015, Carriage is one of the newer heavy metal bands out there that doesn't fucking suck. Being inspired by classic 80s metal bands such as Merciful Fate, Iron Maiden, Sabotage, Angel Witch, Judas Priest, and a band I'm still sort of trying to get into, Lizzie Borden, Carriage's debut album, Visions, has a very classic 80s metal sound with a modern twist, which in the end, fucking destroys. But for me, it's the guitars that really hook me to this band. I don't know if these guys are snorting the essence of Dave Murray, Glenn Tipton, and Nicky Kaye, but fuck, these guys are damn good. They straddle the line between Maiden and Merciful Fate, which is something I didn't even know was possible to juggle those tones, but somehow, they fucking did it. Vocals, however, are a little too King Diamond sounding, which I just said before, the whiny falsetto just ain't my cup of bleach, but Like King Diamond before him, when Robbie Rainey sings normally, he ain't half bad. There's certainly some room for improvement on the vocal department, but nothing, and I mean nothing, on this album even comes close to sucking. One damn strong debut, and I very much look forward to the follow-up. Fucking buy it! Saxon's Thunderbolt is an album that appreciates with every listen. At first, it appears as a solid release by the band after a string of solid releases, but after a few more listens, the band really have produced a fine gem of an album, and I'll say it, a career highlight. I'll put this album up there with Wheels of Steel, Crusader, The Debut, and Denim and Leather. Best song for me is a tie between the two diametrically different songs, one being the ode to Motorhead that was They Played Rock and Roll. Were the boys to be, and they played rock and roll. They played rock and roll. They took no sleep. They tore on. And the second being a song that I will be blasting at full volume every Halloween to come, The Infectious Nosferatu, The Vampire's Waltz. Worst song? Well, I guess this has been a recurring theme, not only on this list, but with Andy Sneap produced albums as well. But no duds on this album either. Thunderbolt is a tour de force, and an album Saxon should be damn proud of 22 fucking albums into their career. Next! Not everyone can make a convincing concept album, let alone a concept trilogy. Whatever your feelings are of the man, you have to at least applaud Blaze Bailey for even considering to undertake such a feat. And even as the Blaze Bailey fanboy that I am, I was still kind of skeptical whether or not even the king of concept albums would even be able to successfully accomplish the task. But the madman fucking did it! 2016, Infinite Entanglement. 2017, Endure and Survive. 2018, The Redemption of William Black, a trilogy of concept albums that have catapulted Blaze to concept legend alongside the Moody Blues, Pink Floyd, Wasp, and King Diamond. They are starving to death. I am mortified to say that I didn't really love this album during my first few listens, but my reasoning was because my expectations were soaring after Endure and Survive set the bar, and during my initial listen, I was just afraid that Blaze and the Absolva Boys may have blown their wad on the masterpiece that was Endure and Survive. But after a few more listens, more songs began to stand out, like the bitchin' riff fest that is The First True Sign. Compared to the other two albums of the trilogy, I do have to rank this one as the worst of the three, but, as a single album, this album is still one of the best albums of 2018, hands down. Best song, for me, the horrendously heart-wrenching 18 Days. I'm still there was no word. She took the hand of his daughter, his world. Feeling abandoned, forsaken, betrayed. She lays them in darkness and drains life away. Weeping as no one before her. A feeling of panic that takes all her breath.
emotions like lava are burning inside, burning with hatred to make me alive.
Worst song? Fuck 'em. This album would have been my number one album of the year, but like a lot of Blaze's albums before, it was the victim of poor timing, and a week after this album drop, a powerful album was fired into this world. Bring on the album of the year. You know, I have to say, while thinking of the placement of this album on the list, I was really trying not to put this one at the top, but honestly, this motherfucking album exceeded all expectation and is just that good. While I love Redeemer of Souls, Firepower was a major improvement over it, and while everyone is saying that it's their best album since Painkiller, I have to say it's their best album since Jugulator, motherfuckers. And speaking of Jugulator, this album sounds like the band actually listened to Jugulator and maybe even a little bit of Demolition and wrote a few tunes that sounds like they could have been on those albums, as evidenced by the second single, Spectre.
Like a thief in the night, with the blade held tight, trapped inside the mind.
And if that's the case, Jugulator, Demolition, and 98 Live Meltdown reissues when, motherfuckers? But Priest fucking did it. And looky who we have here, Andy Sneap, once again. Hey Maiden, maybe it's time to toss Kevin Shirley back into the cave you found him in and stop putting out Queensryche and Dream Theater tribute albums and maybe call Andy fucking Sneap already. How is it that Priest can crank out a scorching epic by the name of Rising from Ruins and not even crack the 5.5 minute mark? Hell, not even one single track on this album even comes close to eclipsing the 6 minute mark, yet Maiden can't even write a fucking single that's less than 17 years long and has more chorus beats than the Chinese population? Look, long songs don't bother me, it's just when the entire album is festooned with songs longer than Gul Dukat's neck is when I start to bitch. But enough about Maiden, that's a rant for another retrospective. Best song? For me, there is no other song on this album that has me headbanging harder than No Surrender. Honestly, you can throw a dart. This album is filled with songs so good that any one of them could be credibly named as the best song on this album. Hell, I've heard the title track, Evil Never Dies, Necromancer, Rising from Ruins, Flamethrower, Spectre, Traitor's Gate, No Surrender, and hell, even the album's close, Sea of Red, all named as an album favorite by different people. Worst song? Not really one, but although if there was a gun to my head and I had to at least pick one song, I'd have to single out Lone Wolf. It's not that it's bad, it's just the song on the album that I've listened to the least. Well, that tears it, motherfuckers. 2018 has been a fan-fucking-tastic year for hard rock and heavy metal, and I can't wait for 2019. I doubt 2019 is going to top it, but we'll see. Until next time, and until next year, I'm Baphomet. Cheers, Metal Maniacs.